There is no room for withholding judgment to make sure that you have all the facts and to make sure that you've assessed the situation properly. Every policy, every message, every public figure must be judged immediately, according to the frameworks and the tenets of the tribe. No exceptions. When the standard bearers and the ideological influencers slap some broad, ill-fitting label on someone and condemn them for being a social justice warrior, a Marxist, a bigot, a fascist, or Hitler, and so on, our failure to immediately co-sign is supposedly a stain on us. It's made to seem like it compromises our credibility or somehow compromises our commitment to the cause of justice or our commitment to the cause of patriotism or whatever is at stake. The implication here, in my opinion, is that thinking is overrated. We just need to stay in line. Let whoever creates the messaging and whoever establishes the agenda, let them do the thinking for us. Again, reserving judgment is bad. Waiting for more facts to have a better informed opinion is unacceptable. And so since I know these are kind of the rules that are set up for us, Chris, by our ideological tribes, one of the rules that I try to follow is to be deliberate about not letting either side make me enraged or ecstatic. I can't let them get me too high or too low simply based off their rhetoric. You can't make it so easy. They shouldn't be able to control you in that way. Because I feel like we need to be able to evaluate the facts and the merits of the case on our own. And I think in some ways, Chris, it's a matter of self-control. We as Christians can't afford to allow anyone to be able to say a word or push a button that guarantees a certain reaction from us every single time. Just let grace speak truth. Restart.
This is the kingdom. You're listening to the And Campaigns Church Politics Podcast, where you can get in-depth political analysis from a biblical worldview. We're not trying to be progressive or conservative. We're trying to be faithful Christians in the public square. This is the kingdom. The kingdom. Yes, it is. Gotta spread the word. Tell the world that you're doing all, doing all. What you know good, Ann Camp. You're listening to the Ann Campaign's Church Politics Podcast with Justin Gibney. That's me. And the Windy City representative, the baddest brother above the Mason-Dixon line, my play cousin, the Right Reverend Christopher Butler. Well, Chris, the Bears did it again. They didn't block too well for their quarterback. They didn't look great, but they pulled off a win against the Texans on Sunday. And I know we will take that win. We'll take any win that we can get. I don't know how long this is going to last. I don't want to get my hopes up too much, but would love to hear your unreasonable, fanatical opinion on this particular game.
Well, you know, it's a good win. I will say, in terms of the offensive line, we haven't gotten it together on pass protection yet, but the run protection is looking good. So we're making progress. I'm telling you, by the time we see the Packers again, we'll be ready to beat them at Soldier Field.
Okay. It just seems like short-term progress because if your quarterback's getting beat up, not only does that make it harder for him to perform as the year goes on, but it makes it harder for him to perform as his career goes on. So I think
the rate of improvement, though, week over week, we're seeing better blocking.
Okay. Okay, keep hope alive, man. I'm gonna have to take your word on that one because I'm not seeing it. But hey, you know who am I? I am a Bears fan, but I'm just a little. I'll take the record. I'm just a little worried about the hits that my man Justin Fields is taking. Who is a Georgian, who happens to be playing on my favorite team right now. So it's all good. Well, we got a lot of stuff to talk about today. Don't even have enough time to, you know, have a lot of banter about sports because we need to get into it. And as always, I want to give a shout out to our sponsor, the Fetzer Institute, for supporting us in what we do and how we do it. Man, I think this is going to be an interesting one. I know some of y'all have been waiting on some of these topics. We're going to get into, we're going to talk about Italy's new prime minister. We're going to talk about a statement made by Stacey Abrams and then get into a little polling. So grab your Bible, get your mind right, and prepare to think not like a Republican, not like a Democrat, but think like a Christian. Chris, one thing about ideological tribalism is that the tribe is always seeking to control your entire public witness. They don't want part of it. They want the entire thing to align with their narratives and storylines. There's no room for variance, no room for nuance, no room for any type of experimentation. There is no room for withholding judgment to make sure that you have all the facts and to make sure that you've assessed the situation properly. Every policy, every message, every public figure must be judged immediately according to the frameworks and the tenets of the tribe. No exceptions. When the standard bearers and the ideological influencers slap some broad, ill-fitting label on someone and condemn them for being a social justice warrior, a Marxist, a bigot, a fascist, or Hitler, and so on, our failure to immediately co-sign is supposedly a stain on us. It's made to seem like it compromises our credibility or somehow compromises our commitment to the cause of justice or our commitment to the cause of patriotism or whatever is at stake. The implication here, in my opinion, is that thinking is overrated. We just need to stay in line. Let whoever creates the messaging and whoever establishes the agenda, let them do the thinking for us. Again, reserving judgment is bad. Waiting for more facts to have a better informed opinion is unacceptable. And so since I know these are kind of the rules that are set up for us, Chris, by our ideological tribes, one of the rules that I try to follow is to be deliberate about not letting either side make me enraged or ecstatic. I can't let them get me too high or too low simply based off their rhetoric. You can't make it so easy. They shouldn't be able to control you in that way. Because I feel like we need to be able to evaluate the facts and the merits of the case on our own. And I think in some ways, Chris, it's a matter of self-control. We as Christians can't afford to allow anyone to be able to say a word or push a button that guarantees a certain reaction from us every single time. And so I try to make sure that there's nothing a progressive or conservative leader can say that'll make me automatically get rapturous or overly despairing. Automatically, right? I am not Pavlov's dog, and you shouldn't be either. We shouldn't be conditioned to the point where our tribes have created these trigger words or these trigger labels that, again, automatically make us respond in a certain way. And I don't care what they're talking about, Chris. I don't care how serious the issue is, whether they're talking about racism, whether they're talking about the sanctity of life, or anything else. Our response should be based on knowing the facts, processing the information, knowing our values and beliefs, having discernment, and being judicious. And you and I both know that none of that is encouraged in the realm of tribalism that we live in today. Now, this is not just true, again, for certain events or certain issues. This is true for public figures as well. Because both sides want to control what we think about every person who steps on the scene. They want you to characterize that person based on their labels without question, without any type of critique of your own. And this was the case, and we should have expected that it would be, this was the case as a new figure stepped onto the world stage earlier this week. Twitter was on fire, Chris. It was full of belligerence. It was full of accusation based on the emergence of Italy's new prime minister, Giorgia Meloni. She had many conservatives excited. She had many progressives, as far as I could tell, frightened. She will be Italy's first female prime minister. Now, usually with our mainstream media, that's going to be the focal point. Anytime you have a first when it comes to women or something like that or anything else, that's going to be their focal point. But there's a problem here. It wasn't the focal point here because Meloni is conservative, which for whatever reason overshadows any kind of first that the mainstream media would primarily be focused on. Now, as soon as she comes up, as soon as you hear this name, she's labeled a fascist. She's labeled a neo-fascist. I saw some people compare her to Mussolini. For some, it sounded like Europe as we know it was coming to an end. I saw conservative commentators who were giving her full monologues of praise and commendation. Someone even called her the woman of Europe's future. But I can't help but think, Chris, that it's a little too soon for us to be drawing those conclusions. I personally don't know enough about her to have any opinion either way. And part of my message today, part of what I want to say in my monologue is that's okay. You don't have to draw an opinion about her leadership or about where Italy's going right now before she's even become a leader or before you even have been able to do any type of due diligence to research her stances. You don't have to take that based on a few tweets. Now, Chris, what really went viral, and I know you've seen it, what really went viral in regard to this election is a speech that she gave a couple years back, excuse me. And in this speech, it was at some conservative event, but in this speech, she attacked globalism. She seemed to attack consumer capitalism. She seemed to attack what we see in the West, but apparently also other places, this kind of Western anti-family sentiment, and also kind of a secular anti-Christian attitude. She attacked those things. And I saw several people who I really don't agree with probably on anything, Dinesh D'Souza, folks like that, who were really big up in and retweeting and promoting this this speech. And so this might cause me to form a negative opinion without listening to it. You see people saying they like the speech, you know that you don't like their opinions, and so you automatically say it's bad. But at the same time, I also had the video sent to me with positive commentary from friends whose beliefs and politics are more closely aligned with my own, which we know when you get information or you get something from people who you are closer to, who you agree with, that might summarily get you to support the message. But what we should all do, whether we see it coming from one source or another, a source we like or a source we don't like, we should all listen to the speech. We should all listen to whatever content's being sent to us before we create any kind of opinion or form any kind of opinion. And so even after listening to the speech, I decided to do it. I decided to not just listen to the clip, but try to listen to the speech. Even after listening to the speech, I still didn't have enough information to form an opinion about the new prime minister. But I can say this, and I think regardless of how she turns out, she could be Mother Teresa. She could be Benito Mussolini. I have no idea how this is going to turn out. But I can say, based on that snippet of what she's thinking, that it was a really strong speech. I thought that, Chris, that it had some assertions that I agreed with that were really strong. And then it had some other things that could possibly be a sign of a type of nationalism that we criticize on this show. Right? I mean, she talked about a lot about national identity. That's not necessarily bad. Right? But we do know that that national identity can be taken to a place which is bad. Does she take it there? Will she take it there? I don't know enough to say. Okay, so in other words, she seems like a very interesting leader. She communicates very well. But the jury is still out. Now, here's the thing, and I'll pass to you after this. I do have to admit that her G.K. Chesterton quote was appreciated. For those of you who've been following this show or just following some of my work, you know that G.K. Chesterton is one of my favorite writers. He's over my shoulder right now, and he's just a brilliant guy. You know, I think he was a brilliant writer. Now, some people will criticize me for even acknowledging G.K. Chesterton because I do think that he was sadly mistaken on some racial issues. But in my opinion, and I know I might not be in the majority when it comes to this opinion, in my opinion, just because somebody has some opinions I disagree with or that are just wrong, that doesn't erase someone like him who had some brilliant insights about secularism and modernity. He was a genius, in my opinion, be it an imperfect genius, just like all the rest of them. But when she quoted him, she was talking about the importance of family, talking about the importance of country, talking about how some modernists are attempting to tear us away from those roots and why they might want to tear us away from those roots. And I think there was some merit to what she was saying. She was attacking the impact of postmodernism, which doesn't believe in absolute truth. So then she quoted Chesterton, and here's the Chesterton quote. She says, "Fires will be kindled to testify that 2 and 2 are 4. Right? That 2 and 2 make 4. Swords will be drawn to prove that leaves are green in the summer." Meaning we will have to go all out just to prove clear truths, indisputable truths. This quote resonated with me because it does seem like parts of secular society are denying some of the most basic truths. They're denying God's general revelation that is clear to all of us, whether you're a Christian or not. And at times it is really tough to watch. I mean, there are some of you listening right now that know you would risk losing your job just by stating the simple fact that man can't get pregnant. It's madness. And a lot of you would never state that on the job. You would never state that in your class because you fear the consequences of that. So I think for people who understand that some of these truths just can't be spoken, this is a speech that kind of resonates with that. And a lot of Black Christians I know were feeling that part of the message. Does it mean that we need know and support her platform? No, not necessarily. But I think it is important to admit that she gave a moving speech and made some points that could help American culture right now. And it's something that we should probably consider. Chris, what's your thought on automatically labeling certain people as they step onto the scene and even about the speech in general?
Yeah, I mean, certainly, you know, it's always hilarious to me when you go on Twitter especially, and all of a sudden, all these people who you never knew followed Italian politics very closely, but then they have like all this thorough analysis on the new prime minister in Italy. So, you know, there are some folks who I looked at with interest because they actually do follow European politics. And I looked at that, though, in the spirit of let's learn about this woman who just got elected there. And certainly I wish that more people took the tact of, hey, something interesting happened somewhere in the world. Let me learn about that. Versus, hey, something interesting happened in the world. Let me analyze that and, you know, put my opinions out about it. I just think that's that is silliness. But I guess people can keep doing it because I find it quite entertaining. You know, that is what that is. But I did go and like I said, I looked at some folks who I do think, you know, who do follow European politics a little bit more closely, you know, just to try to learn more about this particular prime minister and tried to get a hold of the speech. And, you know, in terms of, you know, folks who were dumping on the speech, a couple of things that I would point out, you know, one is that between that speech and right now, she became the prime minister of her country. So there has to be something to the speech. There has to be something to this approach. And again, I don't know enough about her to say for 100% sure. But if you go back and put the Chesterton quote in its context, I mean, it seems like the argument that she's making is really undergirded by some thinking that I think a lot of people you know, kind of resonate with, because the argument that that Chesterton is making in the larger context, where this quote comes from, he's making this argument that there is, I think, what he calls like a march, a great march of mental destruction, right? And it's this idea that he's arguing that truths, I put down this quote, truth turns into dogma the instant they are disputed, right? Truths turn into dogma the instant they are disputed. So he's making this point, right, that, you know, there really was not a need to like fight for the right for parents to protect their children until somebody had the idea that maybe parents don't have the right to protect their children. There was no need for laws about abortion until violence against the unborn became so very commonplace. He's kind of making this argument that things that seem obvious become, you know, quote unquote dogma when folks begin to sort of attack those truths. And that seems to me to be the argument that she's making in her speech. You know, there was a time where you didn't have to, you know, defend the concept of what it is to be a woman, right? And to say that a man is not a woman. Those things didn't have to be debated in intellectual circles. They were understood in kindergarten classrooms. But now they do have to be debated. And I don't know the essence and the nature, you know, sort of like the true essence of the movement that she's leading there in Italy. But I do know that there is something important about acknowledging that things that we used to didn't have to fight for, now we do have to fight for, and that it is important that somebody stands up and fights for it. And the last thing that I will say is that there is, for me, especially in the speech, because she was making this tie between this sort of, you know, sort of ultra liberal, sort of cultural liberal march toward the destruction of thought and that type of thing. But she was making this tie between the forward movement of cultural liberalism and sort of the kind of modern markets and consumerism that also was taking hold of our culture, right? So she's saying that, you know, folks want to destroy identity because they don't want you to be, you know, a woman and a mother and a Christian. They want you to be, you know, identity X, right? Person X, parent number one, parent number two, so that you can be this disimpersoned consumer, right? Like, we don't have to worry about relationships. We don't have to worry about higher truth and moral law. Just be whatever you want to be and consume, consume, consume. And I will say that while I'm not 100% sure that the causal relationship that she sort of lays out in the speech is really there, I know that there is a profound resonance in the argument, because even if it's not causal, I think a lot of us are beginning to see the sort of symbiotic relationship between this kind of cultural liberalism and the forward march of sort of like mass consumerism and the sort of corporate takeover of not just our economy, but also our culture. Mm-hmm. And so that tie that she makes in the speech, again, I don't know that I would argue that it's causal, but there is certainly a coziness that I think it is very resonant to point out. And I think folks who are involved in civics and politics in the United States might take note of that particular fact.
Yeah, no, that's good. That tie was interesting because that kind of punch back, because, you know, she talked about speculators and all that. So it wasn't just a punch at the what can be considered the left. I mean, the right could have took that as a punch as well, right?
Absolutely.
But let me give you the fuller Chesterton quote, because I think it's a brilliant quote. As you said, he said, the great march of mental destruction will go on. Everything will be denied. Everything will become a creed. It is a reasonable position to deny the stones in the street. It will be a religious dogma to assert them. It is a rational thesis that we are all in a dream. It will be a mystical sanity to say that we are all awake. Fires will be kindled to testify that two and two make four. Swords will be drawn to prove that leaves are green in summer. So what he's saying here is like the obvious things, to say that the obvious things aren't real will be seen as reasonable. But to say that the obvious things are real, it becomes something, you know, that's just so outrageous to say. And in so many ways, that's what it's, you know, that's what it's saying. But I think he's also saying, I mean, that's what's happening. But I think he's also saying that these things are worth countering. They are worth standing up for. They are worth saying something about. And that's why I want to say to a lot of Christians, because I think a lot of Christians, we're getting beat up on a lot of these issues. And what you tend to do is rationalize a reason to take the path of least resistance. I can't tell you how many Christians I've talked to recently that when it comes to gender ideology, you can tell that they've rationalized the reason that it's not a big deal to just let it go. And I think what they need to think about, are you doing that because it actually makes sense and that it's really something that you can, where you can come to the conclusion that the world wants you to come to in good faith? Or are you just finding a reason not to have to fight about that, not to have to really move forward and defend the truth? And I think in a lot of cases, it's a latter. We will be right back on the Church Politics Podcast. And we are back on the Church Politics Podcast with Justin Gibney and the Right Reverend Christopher Butler. Well, we just talked about going viral and all this other stuff, but Italy's presumptive new prime minister wasn't the only lady to go viral over the past week or so. There was someone closer to home, someone very close to my home, that also went viral. And unfortunately, how most of us felt about her commentary was all too closely tied to our identity or our ideological perspectives instead of sound judgment. Georgia Democratic gubernatorial candidate Stacey Abrams was talking about abortion at a historically black college in Atlanta when she addressed the issue of fetal heartbeats. And she said this: "There's no such thing as a heartbeat at 6 weeks. It's a manufactured sound designed to convince people that men have the right to take control of a woman's body." Okay. This sparked some pretty tough commentary from the right. Some of it reasonable, some of it completely inappropriate. A few folks used it as an opportunity to attack her weight and the way she looked or something like that. And you know, that's something that we do not honor on the Church Politics Podcast. That's trash. People need to keep that out of the civic discourse. Completely disrespectful. Others tried to say or use this to say that this proves that she's somehow unintelligent. Well, let's be clear. There is nothing, look at her resume, there's nothing unintelligent about Stacey Abrams. You can disagree with her all day. You can disagree with her policies. You can disagree with her platform. But she is a very intelligent and accomplished woman. Comments like that have no credibility. Again, they have no place in the public discourse, especially when we're talking about elections and we're talking about very serious issues that we really need to think seriously about. And I think her story is compelling. She's done a lot of good work on voters' rights and a lot of other issues, and that should not be taken away from her. That said, I think that this statement was completely ridiculous. And it's sad that it was made in front of students from our community who in all likelihood look up to her, who in all likelihood may take her word as given, right? She's taken an extreme hardline position on abortion that doesn't reflect a significant portion of the Black church Christian of the Black Christian community. Now, it may serve the progressive donor class, and it's good when you're trying to break records when it comes to raising money, but it does not serve us. And unfortunately, it's become a trend in national politics that sometimes the people that look like you on certain issues seem to represent the people with the money bag. Now, I'm not taking shots at anybody's integrity or anything like that, but if you look at what's going on, it's problematic and it has become a trend. Not a trend just on one side either, but I think a disturbing trend. I don't know anybody in my community that I go in church with that talks about abortion in that same way. There may be varying opinions, but that was a very extreme view to express. Now, the consensus from the medical community, which isn't controlled by right-wing Christian nationalists, is that her statement was inaccurate. Up until only a little while ago, not that long ago at all, even Planned Parenthood had language on their website that contradicted Abrams' assertion. Now, they changed it, conveniently, but even it was even contradicted there. Not only was the medical consensus against her statement, she chose to attach what can only be described as a conspiracy theory to that statement. She said it is a manufactured sound designed to convince people that men have the right to control a woman's body. Let me try to explain what's going on here. Pro-choice advocates know that the beating of a developing heart does a lot of damage to their narrative about abortion. It's hard to say that this is just a clump of cells. It's hard to say that this is something that we shouldn't care anything about, that we should give no consideration to. When a developing heart is beating and blood is flowing. So instead of conceding the truth, they deny the truth and create a conspiracy theory. That's what we do in American politics today. And I believe that these messages, this propaganda, is doing a lot of damage to our democracy. We have to be willing to concede truths that frustrate our narratives. And in this instance, Stacey Abrams failed to do that. And we cannot just be against conspiracy theories that come from people who don't look like us. We can't just be against conspiracy theories that come from people on the left or on the right, depending on who we like. When anybody uses a conspiracy theory that's completely unfounded to deny the truth, to run away from the facts, to run away from the reality, we have to care. And we have to speak up. And again, whenever we don't always just run to talk about people who are in an election because it always seems like you're trying to have an impact on the election. That's not our intention. But as I've said before, and I'll say again, it is not our responsibility on the Church Politics Podcast to get anybody elected. It's our job to call it like we see it. So this ain't an endorsement. This ain't anything else. This is just calling it how we see it. And when somebody puts a comment out there like that, it has to be critiqued. Go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, I mean, that statement really doesn't even mean anything. Like the logical leap to say that that there is no such thing as a heartbeat. First off, politically, I think that I just want to point out that this is the kind of thing that starts to lose you people, even people who are in the middle, right? Because now you're going to make these statements that you're telling people to kind of like throw away their experience, right? You're telling folks, you know, who have gone for an ultrasound, you know, in a perfectly happy, you know, situation with their child. And you're saying that heartbeat that made you so excited when you heard it, well, that wasn't a thing. That was part of some conspiracy. And so even if you are a pro-choice person, you are going to take some umbrage at a statement like that, because now you're asserting that even a pro-choice person, just by, you know, getting excited about a heartbeat in their own situation, is somehow participating in some broad conspiracy to convince people that men have a right to take over a woman's body. And that doesn't mean anything. You're asserting that like the motivation behind the science that developed the technology to use a Doppler to listen to that heartbeat, that this is all motivated by like this sinister desire to prove and to make the argument, for an abortion ban. And it really is just not that. And I think these are the types of things that elected officials and politicians do often to to really, you know, give away, you know, their sort of political gains, whatever gains were being made around abortion. I think you begin to start to lose people in the middle when you start to take these extreme positions and say things that are, I think, sort of off the beaten path. Mm-hmm. You know, because that really doesn't mean much of anything. And so, you know, I think for those of us who are like in the church community and also engaging in the civic space, there's a profound tie between the last block and this one, because what shouldn't be able to happen is a person running for governor stands up and say something that clearly doesn't make any sense. And then like large national organizations like Planned Parenthood change their websites to adjust their opinion about basic physical facts, observable biological facts. You change those opinions based on the fact that this political leader said something. That begins to like really erode the foundations, because then you'll come back in the pandemic and say, well, trust the science. It's like, well, the science can change if Stacey Abrams changes it, right? And, you know, Stacey Abrams is an intelligent, accomplished woman. She's not a medical doctor or a biologist, and her statements on a panel at a university shouldn't be able to like change, you know, broad opinions about physical realities that have been established for, you know, quite a long time.
And right? And it has an impact on creating other conspiracy theories when people don't trust the because it's not the it could be the American Medical Association or anything like that. Anybody who's impacted by politics, then you get people who just don't trust you, and then you create maybe even more well-founded conspiracy theories on what's going on in the medical community. And just let me say this to head this off, for anybody who's, you know, wondering why we would have some criticism for somebody who's in a race that you might like, you know, somebody who you want to win, let me tell you this, the day when Christians' commentary is based on electoral politics and the impact that it'll have on electoral politics, the day that the AND campaign bases what we say on that is the day we are not prophetic at all. If there's a Christian leader who speaks into the public space and what they have to say is based on the impact that it'll have on the electoral cycle, and that's the basis of what they're going to say, then you don't need to be listening to them. It's not our job to make sure somebody gets in or out. Y'all do that. You take care of, you support who you want to support. You follow their messages. You hand out flyers or whatever goes on. We're going to say what needs to be said, regardless of who it is. And that's one thing that, you know, folks need to realize. But I'll let you take us out, Chris.
Well, I think that's very good, because I would say I'm not voting in Georgia, so it doesn't matter if I support Stacey Abrams or not. But if I were supporting Stacey Abrams, and maybe somebody's listening here who can get this word in, I would be urging the campaign that you could win without doing something like this, right? Like, there are people who you're going to lose who maybe they have a way that they will, you know, support Stacey Abrams, who is more of a pro-abortion type of a candidate, but it's not because they deny the sanctity of the human life that's in the womb. And so when you start making statements that clearly just deny that entire sanctity and say, that's not a baby, that's not a human, you know, you can lose people. And I would just be urging Stacey Abrams and other candidates to just pull off the gas a little bit. I know it seems like the golden political opportunity, but I think you can actually make gains in this space. Like, and I'm talking to people who disagree with me on the policy, right? But you could make gains in the space without going this far.
Can you raise as much money?
That's a word. I would say you can win without going this far.
Okay. I hear you. You know what I'm saying? But I just want y'all to know, and y'all know we don't hold back. You know what I'm saying? We're going to say what we have to say. But the day that the church's message is based on what's happening in electoral politics, man, we in a bad situation. When we can only be prophetic when it's politically expedient. We'll be right back on the Church Politics Podcast. And we are back on the Church Politics Podcast with Justin Gibney and the Right Reverend Christopher Butler. We're going to have a shorter, we went over a little bit on the last two, but I hope you enjoyed those conversations, much needed conversations. Want to talk a little bit about polls, Chris. I just read a Politico article entitled Pollsters Fear That They're Blowing It Again in 2022. And here's what it said. It says, pollsters know that they have a problem, but they aren't sure they fixed it in time for the November election. Since Donald Trump's unexpected 2016 victory, pre-election polls have consistently understated support for Republican candidates compared to the votes ultimately cast. Once again, polls over the past 2 months are showing Democrats running stronger than once expected in a number of critical midterm races. It's left some wondering whether the rosy results are setting the stage for another potential polling failure that dashes Democratic hopes of retaining control in Congress and vindicates the GOP's assertion that the polls are unfairly biased against them. Chris, based on my reading of the polls in 2016, I was very surprised when Donald Trump won. I was really, really surprised. So I say that to say that I'm familiar with the flop, the polling flop that happened in 2016. Something that some people would say is going on now, too, to add to that, is because a lot of Republicans or a lot of Trump people don't trust the poll, don't trust polling people or any of that. They're not giving the, either not giving them answers or they're giving them the wrong answers. And so it's messing up the polling purposefully. I don't know exactly what's going on, but I would warn folks about watching the polls. Another X factor within these polls that might have helped Democrats jump up is the Dobbs decision that overturned Roe versus Wade did motivate, whether it's temporary or whether it's going to be long lasting, it did motivate a lot of Democrats. So that could have, that could account for the change in the polling. Any thoughts on this, on these polling, on this polling back and forth, Chris?
Yeah, I just think that polling is a discipline that's in big trouble because our world is moving so fast with the rate of the news cycle and you know, everybody getting so much information. By the time your polling is done, you're like in a whole different world. And so I would just remind people, and it probably feels a little bit old school, but one of my early political mentors told me that every candidate has to always have what he called a pookie phone call. But what that means is you got to have a way of knowing what's happening on the ground. And I would just urge people that there are other ways of knowing other than polling. So we'll see, you know, the great poll is coming in about a month's time, a little bit over a month, and we'll know. But, you know, I think that polling is in trouble because it's hard to keep up with the rate of the world. Plus all those other confounding factors, you know, is always going to undersample less educated voters because polling is more of like this. It's in the domain of academia a little bit already. So, you know, we'll see.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, there's only one poll that counts, and that's when we go to the polls on election day. And it's good to try to anticipate what might happen and things of that nature, but it's hard to tell. It's not always an exact science, and we've seen that over and over again. But there are some factors that say it, maybe it is accurate. Hard to tell. No, nobody really knows.
Yeah, I always heard folks in campaigns to try to synthesize these different ways of knowing, right? So you have polling, you got your pookie phone call, right? You see what's happening with your own field campaign. You got to synthesize all of that stuff because not any one of those things is not going to give you a clear picture.
Completely agree with that. Well, Ann Camp, thanks for joining us again today for this episode. I hope you enjoyed it. As always, if you want to support us, you can support us through our Patreon, which is patreon.com/churchpolitics. We are going to start putting a lot more of our content on there for folks who are helping us out. And you can always go to the Ann Campaign's website to support the movement. Don't just stand on the sidelines. Be a part of this. There's a lot going on in the public square. The church needs to be heard, and we're doing our best to do that. And Camp, there's a cross that neither political conservatism nor progressivism is fit to bear. There's a civic hearing in need of faithful witnesses who love social justice and won't surrender the truth to be loved by the world. Politic with the boldness and compassion of Jesus Christ. Until next time, And Camp, we'll holler at you.